can fit in any one of those four intentionalities. You can call it social innovation, but still could be maintaining innovation. Before they didn't have a village farm, but what they were doing was strengthening the existing culture, strengthening the relationships. There was nothing principle information about it. It was a social innovation. Wasn't it a co-creation of reality, a new reality?
What is it?
I doubt it. So that's why it's a wishy-washy concept.
Okay.
Now the reason why I had to kind of go into that whole distinction between what is your intentionality with your ICT4D research, I was asked to write this encyclopedia entry on gender and ICT, and I looked at all the conceptualizations used, from the World Bank to Dawn, you know, developing alternatives for new age, and everybody is using empowerment. Many people are using emancipation, but what is the intentionality? And that's why I, in the encyclopedia entry, fought for having that distinction in conceptual intentionality accepted, although it's not logical for an encyclopedia entry to do that, because otherwise nobody could make sense of that, you know, conceptual universe, because everybody's talking empowerment. Doesn't mean that everybody has the same intentionality, that it has the same effect? No. So social innovation, I would say, careful. What is intentionality? Here, intent is where you put it. You want to put it on keeping the identity as it is. Your social innovation will keep the situation as it is. If you say, okay, no, there's a dream out there, that's my social innovation, that will be a new co-creation. And why that is still so difficult to grasp is because the concept of intentionality is still very much kept under the table. And it should be. Okay.
That Facebook, I mean, the intention of Facebook wasn't just to create some platform for chatting and things, but
well, let me
as in consequence,
let me correct you there.
Was more personal,
the intention, I think, of Mark Zuckerberg was to create a social dating site, and I think he already had a problem with women, so it was basically about exposing women and making them commodifying them who they were.
So the intention of the designer was something else, kind of go out of the box, explore this new platform and do whatever you want to do. But as a consequence, later on, like, we have all shifted. We society have shifted in parts and in whatever to fit the paradigm of communicating and sharing via social media?
Yes and no. Yes and no.
No, that's just...
Look, Facebook at the moment is used for political mobilization, for empowerment, for a lot of issues. But if you follow what is happening, the accusations of misogyny are continuing. That misogynist first impetus is still a problem. Were you aware of the 2013 open letter of all those organizations against Facebook? Facebook didn't kind of change the friends icon, you know, because they felt like it. It is because there was a whole campaign against what they call the big misogyny of Facebook. It is still there. Because
it's everywhere.
Yes.
It's everywhere.
Yes. But because Facebook is, while it claims it has become a public space, it is not amenable to democratic input like a national newspaper or national broadcaster. I have my, you know, mechanisms for dealing with oppression in the public space, but Facebook is a public, private space. And the ones who are in charge ultimately are the moderators. And they are chosen by a specific mindset, intentionality, by the ones who are owning it. And because it's a male-dominated world, it's about advertising income. It is still very much okay to show violence against women, but not women breastfeeding and in public. So we can't, even with our designs, escape that influence. Even though there is more to us as human beings than misogyny, the way how Facebook is set up, and because it's owned by those people with that mindset, that mindset has a much bigger influence than, for instance, a public space that was created with a different intentionality. I know it sounds maybe wacky, but...
Don't you think these people that own Facebook have gone through their own processes of emancipation? Yeah, they make a lot of money, of course, but they've gone through their own processes as well.
I do not think that necessarily, if you are on the right side as a white male, that you necessarily go automatically through emancipation. No. Yes?
Maybe my question is a little bit different. What is your take on intentions and ethics?
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, there was, of course, a time when Western society was basically governed by ethics, Christian ethics. I'm not saying that hypocrisy didn't take place or women's empowerment. I mean, we had witch hunts and everything. But right now, there is an ethical vacuum I'm now speaking only for Western society. In the Middle Ages, the main myth was about religion. And if you are kind of behave yourself well in this life, then you go to heaven. So there was this kind of check. It was convoluted, it became corrupted, that's why the whole proliferation of Christian religion. But there was that as a myth. Right now, the only myth we have is money, is economy. So, not only has the economy become the main institution, there's also this myth that you basically can trample on people, and as long as you get away with the biggest goodies, you're fine. That's the main myth. People that are wealthy are adored. Even when they are wealthy, becoming wealthy because of oppression of other people, exploiting of the environment. Because wealth itself is adored, that's the main myth. Instead of wisdom, or love, or compassion, or caring, or prudence. Like in the Middle Ages, it was prudence. And before, I know a little bit about Greek ancient society, it was very much the ancient value ethics. About prudence, about living a good life, about taking care of yourself because that makes you a responsible citizen. So that is why I often say, really, we need to create a new paradigm for our world in order to survive. We have to change the main myth. And it is shifting a bit, like what Carlos spoke about the young people in Spain. Here now, with your dialogues on transformation, roads must fall. It's not about, there are always many players on the board. But underneath it all, I think, and the acknowledgement that basically the Freedom Charter was already betrayed in Oppenheimer's living room, in Parktown, that is now finally being discussed 25 years after the fact. So maybe for me it's a sign, instead of getting away with, you know, undermining certain people, for me it is, there's the hope that people realize that we are running this world with the wrong myth. It's not okay to kind of, like what Walmart is doing, employ all those people below below with a wage that I need food stamps. So the rest of taxpayers in the United States are basically, funding Walmart's wealth.
My second question is, you mentioned Sudan and Uganda. What is your take on intentions and the unintended consequences?
Intentions and intended consequences?
No, intentions that were not come out, but they were not intended. As a consequence of the good intentions.
Effects.
Yes.
Well, that again, it's like, what is the paradigm? What was the whole context in which you are speaking? When you speak very much in the new Newtonian development paradigm, where you have development outcomes, objectives, then unintended effects is something like, oh my God, I wanted this effect and something else happened. And I thought I knew it all, but obviously I didn't. Okay, so in that paradigm, unintended effect means that. And it is still like a half excuse. Oh, it's very bad what happened. In my book, that is kind of excusing your own parents.
Okay.
And you say like, oh, I had this great effect.
Yeah.
I thought it would work here, that because it worked there. Hey, it doesn't work here. On the contrary, it's very bad for them, but it's unintended. I'm okay. I'm saying you're not okay because you used the wrong method. You may have applied it reliably, but you used the wrong method. So no, you're not excused. But in this, what he calls that pluralism, what I call the fourth paradigm, we don't even as so much make an issue about the concept of intended effect. We talk about emergence. We didn't know that one of the outcomes of the Race Project was a radio show about sex in Sudan. So we don't speak about unintended effects because we didn't have intended effects in the first place. We let it emerge. Because reality is complex. Maybe if she would have had a different personality, maybe she would have created a movie. The first soft porn movie in Sudan. Who knows?
You let it emerge. But if the emergency is negative, or
to be negative to who?
You see, that is where the relationship between intentions and
value.
Yes, because the moment you have your intentions, read chapter 22 of our book, the second grace book, then you will see how intentions basically permeate all the values, all the decisions, all the relationships, all the roles, all the behavior. Because they are aligned with the ultimate purpose. And so a lot of the things that would maybe create something nasty, you let go because you say that's not part of my intended ultimate purpose. You see what I mean?
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, so you will see the project map in chapter 22 of the second grace book. You can download it for free from the web, the book,
right,
by the way. Anything else? Or yes?
Do you have some junior different examples and experiences, some sort of collective approaches? Because I'm doing the same thing, I'm working bottom-up, I'm working with emergence, I let it unfold, and I'm grateful to the university because I come from the United Nations, working with non-governmental organizations and whatever else. I moved from UN, NGOs, and then community-based organization, and then the university was my, let's be free from any logical framework and let it unfold, and that being, and the magic happened. Lot of magic.
Exactly.
And it's also really a lot of magic. I love it to pieces.
Exactly.
And I adore it because it's like you giving words, expressing it in such a beautiful way. But I was just wondering the examples of collective, because the example I'm making, like the lady in Sudan or any other one, is them moving out of the space and then changing the environment. I'm working with groups and collectivities.
No, 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 no. She is